Hello all, now let's discuss about the drugs which inhibit nucleic acid or DNA in a bacteria or antimicrobials which inhibit DNA, DNA inhibitors. So they are divided into two DNA inhibitors. The first drug is the drug which will cause direct DNA or nucleic acid damage. Okay, direct DNA damage. Now, how these drugs will cause direct DNA damage? These drugs inside the bacteria, they will form a free radical of nitric oxide. They forms nitric oxide free radical, and this nitric oxide, it causes direct DNA damage. Okay, it causes direct DNA damage. Among them, we have the first drug as nitroimidazoles. Okay, nitroimidazoles. Among this nitroimidazole, we will discuss a very famous drug, that will be metronidazole. And the second class of drug we have is nitrofurantoin. Okay, nitrofurantoin. So these drugs, they cause direct DNA damage by formation of nitric oxide free radicals. The radicals of nitric oxide will damage DNA. Now the second we have is DNA gyrase and topoisomerase 4 inhibitor. Okay, topoisomerase 4 inhibitor. Now this enzyme, DNA gyrase and topoisomerase 4, they are required for DNA synthesis. Okay, DNA replication occurs because of these enzyme. The drug which inhibit them are, you will write, fluoroquinolones. Okay, fluoroquinolones. And the last drug we have is novobiosin. Okay, so this is the complete list of the drugs which generally inhibit DNA and DNA gyrase. Okay, now you must remember one point. These first two drugs, they are bactericidal drug. Okay, they are cidal drug. They cause complete killing. While these two drugs in the last, they are bacteriostatic drug. Okay, they are bacteriostatic drug. Okay, so let's discuss each of these drugs one by one. So let's start with the first one, that is nitroimidazoles. Okay, let's make a heading, nitroimidazoles. Now, among nitroimidazoles, we have various drugs. The most famous drug we have is metronidazole. So we have various drugs like metronidazole. Okay, you'll write other drugs like tinidazole, ornidazole. Okay, you'll write cetranidazole. And lastly, you will write secnidazole. So as you can see, these drugs, they are ending with a similar word, that is dazole. Okay, dazole word is coming. So you can easily remember. Okay, now you must write that this metronidazole overall is the shortest acting drug we have. It is the shortest acting drug, and this secnidazole overall is the longest acting drug we have. Longest acting. And cetranidazole, I will tell you that it will be the only drug that does not cause. It is the only drug that does not cause one side effect known as disulfiram-like reaction. It will not cause disulfiram-like reaction. All other drug will be causing this side effect. Okay, so keeping this thing in mind, let's see what is the pharmacokinetic. These drugs can be given orally as well as IV. Okay, and let's see the uses. Okay, for uses, you can write one mnemonic, that is get D gap in metro. Metro means metronidazole is the drug of choice. This group is the drug of choice. So the first use is G. You'll write they are the drug of choice for giardiasis. They are the drug of choice for giardiasis. Now the drug of choice for giardiasis instead of metronidazole has become single dose tinidazole. That is, single dose tinidazole is the most preferred drug for giardiasis. Then you will write E for entamoeba histolytica infection. Entamoeba histolytica, remember, it causes amoebiasis. It causes amoebiasis. So it is given in both amoebic, dysentery. Drug of choice is metronidazole and its brothers. And you can write hepatic, amoebic, abscess. Okay. So the drug of choice is metronidazole like drug. Third, you will write T for metronidazole is the drug of choice for Trichomonas vaginalis infection. It's a very important question because it is the most common pathogen which causes vaginal discharge in females. Okay, Trichomonas vaginalis, drug of choice is metronidazole. D for it is the drug of choice for one worm known as Dracunculus. Dracunculus worm, which is also known as Guinea worm. Okay. Now next G stand for it is the drug of choice for Gardnerella, which is also known as bacterial vaginosis. Again, the drug of choice is metronidazole. Okay, the drug of choice is metronidazole. Now A for you will write they are the drug of choice for anaerobic infection. Everywhere they are the drug of choice. Okay, anaerobic infection, they are the drug of choice metronidazole. Like example is you'll write bacteroids. Bacteroides fragilis. You can write other infections like Clostridium, tetanus, Clostridium botulinae, which causes botulinum toxin. Because they are anaerobic bacteria, drug of choice is metronidazole. Then you will write they are also the used in pseudomembranous colitis, which is caused by Clostridium perfringens. Again, an anaerobic bacteria. Clostridium difficile infection. Again, an anaerobic bacteria. And lastly, it is also given in peptic ulcers due to Helicobacter pylori. Helicobacter pylori peptic ulcer. So these are the uses of metronidazole. So you'll write a mnemonic, get the gap in metro. G for giardiasis, E for entamoeba, T for Trichomonas vaginalis, Dracunculus, etc. Okay. Now let's see what are the side effects of metronidazole we have. So metronidazole, the most common side effect is dysgeusia. Dysgeusia means altered taste sensation. It causes metallic taste. The mouth becomes metallic taste, it causes dysgeusia. Second, you will write that metronidazole like drug, they also cause. Metronidazole like drug, they also cause dark or brown colored urine. Brown colored urine. Third, you also write they cause disulfiram like reaction in chronic alcoholics. So that is why they are avoided in active drinkers, alcoholics. Okay, except we know is cetranidazole. Cetranidazole does not cause. Now why it is important? Because amoebiasis like infection, they are very common in alcoholics. In alcoholics, metronidazole may cause dangerous disulfiram like reaction, and amoebiasis drug of choice is again metronidazole. So it should be used very cautiously. And last point you will write, it may cause seizures. Okay. So these are the side effects of metronidazole. Understood? Now let's talk about the next class of drug, that is fluoroquinolones. okay, fluoroquinolones. Now, what is the mechanism of action of fluoroquinolone? Fluoroquinolone, they inhibit DNA gyrase enzyme. And also, they inhibit topoisomerase 4 enzyme. They inhibit topoisomerase 4 enzyme, which is present in bacteria. Remember, in humans, topoisomerase 4 is not present. In humans, if you talk about, this DNA gyrase is not present. And topoisomerase 4 is also not present. Instead of topoisomerase 4, topoisomerase 1 and 2 are present. In humans, 4 is not present. So these drugs, they selectively inhibit bacterial growth without interfering with human. Now, what is the function of DNA gyrase? So DNA gyrase, remember, it removes positive supercoiling of DNA. Positing supercoiling of DNA, which occurs during DNA replication, and it introduce negative supercoils. What does it mean? We will discuss about it. And what is the function of topoisomerase 4 enzyme? Topoisomerase 4 enzyme, during catenation of DNA, you will write, during catenation of DNA, it will keep the strands of DNA separated, so that two strands of DNA remain separated. This is the function of this enzyme. Now, what does it mean? Now, suppose, sir, this is a normal DNA. Let's call this DNA as positively. Normally, DNA remains supercoiled. What happens? This DNA gyrase, if we inhibit this, it will introduce negative supercoil. Let's say this is the positive supercoil of the DNA. When you will give inhibit DNA gyrase, the DNA conformation changes. It becomes like this. It becomes totally opposite. Okay, this is known as introduction of negative supercoil. So it was become positive, now it will become negative. So DNA structure becomes changed. Now what happens when DNA becomes synthesized? Remember, DNA, two sets of DNA, they remain separated from chromosome with the help of topoisomerase 4 enzyme. So one set of DNA remains separated from other set of DNA with the help of topoisomerase 4 enzyme. If you inhibit them, these two strands will not become separated and they join among themselves and the cell cannot function. Okay. So in short word, what you have to remember, that fluoroquinolone inhibit DNA gyrase and topoisomerase 4 enzymes. Okay. Now let's see what are the drugs we have. Now, if you talk about the drugs, the first drug among fluoroquinolones was not fluoroquinolone. The first drug which we made was just quinolone. The first drug was just quinolone. And the name of that drug was nalidixic acid. Okay, nalidixic acid. Now, this nalidixic acid nowadays is rarely used. It is nowadays rarely used as urinary antiseptic. Okay, it is nowadays rarely used as a urinary antiseptic for the treatment of chronic UTI. Now, what is urinary antiseptic? That we will discuss shortly in this section only as a separate chapter. Okay, now with this quinolone, now we have attached various fluorine molecules. When we have attached fluorine molecules to them, now they have become now fluoroquinolones. Okay, now they have become fluoroquinolones. Okay, now fluoroquinolones, remember, they have better oral absorption, and as compared to nalidixic acid, they are longer acting drug. So for systemic infection, they are better drugs. Okay, they are better drugs. Now, what are the drugs? Remember, all fluoroquinolones, they will end with the word floxacin. All fluoroquinolone, they will end with the word floxacin. So let's discuss about the first fluoroquinolone which we made. The first was norfloxacin. Okay, then we made many other like lomifloxacin. Okay, we made lomifloxacin, then we made ciprofloxacin. And you can write ofloxacin. Now, these fluoroquinolones, remember, they are mainly given for gram-negative infection. They are mainly given for gram-negative infection. So, if you talk about this Norflox and Lomiflox, they are given for E. coli. And because of this reason, it is given in UTI infection. Okay? It is given in UTI infection. If you talk about the uses of ciprofloxacin uses are very important for you. You will write where ciprofloxacin is used, the mnemonic is PTM. The mnemonic of ciprofloxacin is PTM. So you will write ciprofloxacin is the drug of choice for, you will write Pseudomonas. Why? Because it is the only oral drug for Pseudomonas we have. Rest all other anti-pseudomonal drug are injectable. A for anthrax, it is the drug of choice. Okay? It is the drug of choice everywhere. Anthrax. Y for you will cite pyelonephritis. It is the drug of choice. T for it is the drug of choice for traveler's diarrhea. Ciprofloxacin. And lastly, it is given in meningococcal prophylaxis. Prophylaxis of meningococcal meningitis. So meningococcal meningitis causes, meningococci causes pro meningitis, so it is given in meningococcal prophylaxis. So these are the uses of this ciprofloxacin, and you will write ofloxacin, it is also known as respiratory fluoroquinolone. It is also known as respiratory fluoroquinolone. Why it is known as respiratory fluoroquinolone? We will discuss shortly. Because it is given in pneumonias. It is given in pneumonias of ofloxacin. Okay? So try to remember them. Now, before going further, just write one point with ciprofloxacin. Now, ciprofloxacin side effect is ciprofloxacin is a very potent enzyme inhibitor. Among all fluoroquinolone, it is the most potent enzyme inhibitor. It inhibits various CYP enzyme. Because of this reason, ciprofloxacin inhibits the degradation of drug theophylline. So the levels of theophylline in the body increases. Hence, ciprofloxacin may cause theophylline toxicity. Okay? It may cause theophylline toxicity. So try to remember this part. Okay? So among fluoroquinolone, this ciprofloxacin is a very potent enzyme inhibitor. It inhibits CYP and the degradation of theophylline is inhibited. Theophylline may produce toxicity like scissors. Scissors can be precipitated. Okay, so try to remember. Now the second group of drugs which we have made, they are predominantly effective against gram-positive bacteria. They are predominantly effective against gram-positive bacteria. So these first generation, they are predominantly effective against gram-negative. Second, they are mainly effective against gram-positive bacteria. So what are these drugs? You can write many drugs are there. You'll write first, levofloxacin. Okay? You'll write levofloxacin. Second, you will write, apart from levofloxacin, you will write gatifloxacin. You'll write gemifloxacin. Gemifloxacin. And lastly, you will write ofloxacin. Sorry, moxifloxacin. Now, these four drugs, they are also known as respiratory fluoroquinolones. Okay? Respiratory fluoroquinolones. Even you can add a drug ofloxacin. Now, why they are known as respiratory fluoroquinolone? Because they are effective against स्ट्रेप्टोकोकस न्यूमोनिया, ओके, स्ट्रेप्टोकोकस न्यूमोनिया विच इज अ ग्राम पॉजिटिव ऑर्गेनिज्म. यू राइट, दे आर इफेक्टिव अगेंस्ट क्लेप्सियला विच इज अ ग्राम नेगेटिव ऑर्गेनिज्म, ओके. दे आर ऑल्सो इफेक्टिव अगेंस्ट लीजियोनेला, दे आर ऑल्सो इफेक्टिव अगेंस्ट क्लेमाइडिया एंड दे आर ऑल्सो इफेक्टिव अगेंस्ट माइकोप्लाज्मा. नाउ दिस बैक्टीरिया दे आर ए टिपिकल बैक्टीरिया, दे डोंट हैव सेल वॉल. तो ग्राम पॉजिटिव एंड ग्राम नेगेटिव इज ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ सेल वॉल. स्ट्रेप्टोकोकस न्यूमोनिया इज ग्राम पॉजिटिव, क्लेप्सियला इज ग्राम नेगेटिव, लीजियोनेला, क्लेमाइडिया, माइकोप्लाज्मा आर ए टिपिकल बैक्टीरिया एंड दिस बैक्टीरियाज आर द मोस्ट कॉमन बैक्टीरिया विच आर इम्प्लीकेटेड इन द कॉजेशन ऑफ न्यूमोनिया. दिस बैक्टीरियाज दे वेरी कॉमनली कॉज न्यूमोनिया. बिकॉज ऑफ दिस रीजन दिस फोर फ्लोरोक्विनोलॉन्स आर नोन एज रेस्पिरेटरी फ्लोरोक्विनोलॉन एंड यू विल राइट दे आर यूज इन कम्युनिटी एक्वायर्ड न्यूमोनिया. They are very commonly used in community acquired pneumonias because they will cover all the organisms, most of the organisms which are causing pneumonias. The first point. Second point you will write that fluoroquinolones like ofloxacin, levofloxacin, sorry. First you will write OMGL. मॉक्सीफ्लॉक्सेसिन, गैटीफ्लॉक्सेसिन एंड लीवोफ्लॉक्सेसिन. दीज फ्लोरोक्विनोलॉन्स यू विल राइट दैट दे आर अप्रूव्ड फॉर द ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ एमडीआर टीबी. दे आर अप्रूव्ड फॉर द ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ एमडीआर टीबी दैट इज मल्टी ड्रग रेजिस्टेंट टीबी, ओके. And among them, this moxifloxacin is the most effective against TB. Most effective. But levofloxacin is most commonly used. Why it is most commonly used? Because it is cheap. Okay? Most commonly. Now remember, these fluoroquinolones are also effective against MAC infection. MAC stand for Mycobacterium avium complex. So it is another type of mycobacteria like TB. Okay? So these fluoroquinolones, they are given in mycobacterial diseases. Okay? Mycobacterial diseases. So keep this thing in point. Now let's see certain pharmacokinetics of fluoroquinolone. Okay? Now, if you remember pharmacokinetic, it is similar to tetracyclines. Similar to tetracyclines. So you will write they also chelate with calcium and other divalent atoms. Because of this reason, they should be avoided with food. That means they should be taken as an empty stomach. They should be avoided with food, and you can write antacids also, because antacids, they contain magnesium, aluminium, etc. like atoms. Okay. Second point, they are contraindicated in children generally less than 18 years of age. Or age group is less than 18 years. Unless and until if there is some serious or compelling indication, we don't use fluoroquinolone less than 18 years of age. And they are contraindicated in pregnancy also. Unless and until there is some serious indication. The reason is they chelate with calcium. Because of this reason, they cause cartilage and bone damage. Okay, which may lead to arthropathy. There will be severe joint destruction. Okay, there will be severe joint destruction. So remember this part. Now next point is you will write that they are contraindicated in renal failure also. So fluoroquinolones are contraindicated in renal failure, except the only three, there are only three fluoroquinolones which are safe in renal failure. The safe fluoroquinolone in renal failure are pfloxacin, moxifloxacin, and trovafloxacin. So these fluoroquinolones, remember, they are safe in renal failure. Try to remember PMT word. Now you write certain points that among them, highest CSF penetration or entry into the brain or CSF penetration is by pfloxacin. That is why sometimes pfloxacin is given in meningitis. You write longest. Longest acting is sparfloxacin, which goes sabse paar tak. But remember, this sparfloxacin is banned drug. So the drug which is the longest acting and used is moxifloxacin. Okay, moxifloxacin. Okay, so try to remember. And the last point you will write, that fluoroquinolones, they are absolutely contraindicated in epilepsy patient, because fluoroquinolones, they increase or causes seizures. Fluoroquinolones, they cause seizures. Okay, and specially when they are combined with, when fluoroquinolones, they are combined with NSAIDs and theophylline, they commonly cause seizures. Okay, they commonly cause seizures, and they have a very peculiar side effect. The peculiar side effect of fluoroquinolone is, in old age patient or elderly patient, they cause a very peculiar side effect known as tendinitis. Okay, that there will be inflammation of tendons, and even Achilles tendon have been ruptured by their use. Okay, so remember, tendinitis is their most characteristic or very peculiar side effect in old age. They cause damage of tendons and ligaments. Okay, so try to remember. Now fluoroquinolone, as you have seen, they have lot of side effect. Because of this reason, many fluoroquinolones have been banned. So let's talk about certain banned fluoroquinolone. The first is sparfloxacin. Sparfloxacin and lomifloxacin. Now why they got banned? You will write, because they were causing photosensitivity and they were causing increase in QT prolongation, which may lead to arrhythmia. As they cause photosensitivity, remember, fluoroquinolones, they are never given as a topical drug. They are never given as a topical drug. Now, there was one drug which got banned because of severe photosensitivity, that is clinafloxacin. So clinafloxacin also got banned because of photosensitivity. Okay, don't write this part. Then you will write, other reasons for the ban. You will write trovaflox. Trovafloxacin got banned because of hepatotoxicity. You'll write temafloxacin. Temafloxacin got banned because of immune hemolytic anemia. Okay, then you will write gripafloxacin. Gripafloxacin got banned because it was causing same QT prolongation. And lastly, you will write gatifloxacin. Now, gatifloxacin got banned because it was interfering with glucose. Initially, it was causing hypoglycemia, which could be dangerous. and after that it was causing hyperglycemia. Hypo and hyperglycemia. But remember, this gatifloxacin is available as a topical eye drops. As a topical eye drops, it is available. Okay? It is available. So it got banned because of oral and IV drug. Oral and IV drug was causing hypoglycemia. But remember, recently, this gatiflox have been again available for the treatment of MDR-TB. Because that's a big problem. So this gatiflox also is been available in MDR-TB, but in our program we are not using it. Okay, it's effective against MDR-TB, but in our program we are not using it. Okay, so these are the banned fluoroquinolones. Now let's talk about a drug known as nitrofurantoin. Okay, you'll write nitrofurantoin is a urinary antiseptic. And what is urinary antiseptics? We will be discussing shortly. And the last drug we have is novobiosin, which is a DNA gyrase inhibitor. Now, novobiosin is now not used. It is not used clinically. Okay, but it is used in a testing known as novobiosin sensitivity test. It is used in a novobiosin sensitive test. It is used to distinguish between staph, epidermidis with staphylococcus aureus, staphylococcus saprophyticus. Okay, now both of this staphylococcus are coagulase negative staphylococcus, but remember, this staphylococcus epidermidis gets killed by novobiosin and it is not killed by novobiosin. So it is used to distinguish between the growth of staph epidermidis from staphylococcus saprophyticus. Okay, so this novobiosin is an effective drug against, it is effective drug against staphylococcus aureus. It is effective against staphylococcus aureus, but it is not used, especially MRSA. The only use of novobiosin is, it is used in a testing known as novobiosin sensitivity test. Okay, the only use is novobiosin sensitivity test. So let's make a heading now, urinary antiseptics. Okay, urinary antiseptics. Now, urinary antiseptic means these drugs, they are given orally. These drugs, they are given orally. They will come into the blood and they get rapidly excreted out in kidney. When they come into the blood, they get rapidly excreted out in kidney, in urine through kidney. So they are not given for systemic infection, but can we say that they are concentrated in bladder? They get concentrated in bladder. Because of this reason, they can be given in cases of chronic UTI. They can be given in cases of chronic UTI. Okay, understood this point? Because when they are given orally, they get concentrated in bladder and the surface of the bladder will become sterilized. When the surface of the bladder becomes sterilized, can we say it is now antiseptic? Antiseptic is given on a surface. Okay, chronic UTI. So just remember one point, if there is kidney failure, these drugs should not be given. So these drugs are contraindicated in renal failure. These drugs are contraindicated in renal failure. Understood this point? So let's see what are the drugs we have among urinary antiseptics. Drugs. So you'll write the names of the drugs as N, and lastly MF. The first N stands for norfloxacin. Norfloxacin is given for chronic UTI caused by E. coli. Then you will write nalidixic acid. It is also given in chronic UTI due to E. coli. Now the point is, nalidixic acid nowadays is very rarely used. Okay. Then you will write nitrofurantoin. Now nitrofurantoin is also given in chronic UTI due to E. coli. Okay. Lastly, you will write methenamine mandylate. Now till now we know that the first two drugs, they are fluoroquinolones. They are quinolones or fluoroquinolones. Nitrofurantoin, we know it's a nitric oxide donor. Okay. And nitric oxide will kill a bacteria. Methenamine mandylate, remember, it generates formic acid. It generates formic acid. And this formic acid kills bacteria. And it is also given in chronic UTI due to E. coli. Okay. Now remember, these drugs, they are only effective in acidic urine. They are only effective in acidic urine, especially E. coli, because 70% of the UTI, 70% of UTI are due to E. coli only. Okay. But remember that they are not effective against, they are not effective against infections like Proteus, because Proteus turns the pH of urine alkaline. Proteus turns the pH of urine alkaline. How? Because Proteus, it split urea into the urine into ammonia. And this ammonia turns the pH of urine alkaline, hence they are not effective against Proteus. Okay, so try to remember. Now the last drug we have is phosphomycin. You'll write phosphomycin is a cell wall inhibitor. Okay, it's a cell wall inhibitor, and you will write phosphomycin is even effective against E. coli, and it is even effective against Proteus. It is also given in enterococcal infection. Enterococcal infection also. Okay. So phosphomycin has a very broad spectrum. It's a very preferred drug nowadays for the treatment of chronic UTI. It can be given in all infections. Okay. It can be given in all infections. Now, the most preferred drug, you'll write now, the most preferred drug for the treatment of UTI is nowadays, is a beta lactam with a beta lactamase inhibitor. Okay, beta lactamase inhibitor like amoxicillin, clavulinic acid, etc. Okay, now you will write UTI in pregnancy, because in pregnancy UTI occurs very repetitively again and again. So you can write the drugs which are safe on UTI in pregnancy are, you'll write NCAP. Okay, you'll write NCAP. The first is nitrofurantoin. It is now considered as a best drug for chronic UTI in pregnancy. You'll write cefalexin. You'll write amoxicillin clavulinic acid. And one newer penicillin, you will write pevmicillinam. Pevmicillinam. So these are the drugs which are given in chronic UTI in pregnancies. Okay. Chronic UTI in pregnancy. Now, so this completes our urinary antiseptic. Just remember, there is a drug known as phenazopyridine. There's a drug known as phenazopyridine. Now, phenazopyridine is not an antiseptic. You will write it is a urinary analgesic. Analgesic means it will relieve the pain of burning micturition. It is a pain reliever. It is given in dysuria, which is also known as painful or burning micturition. Okay, painful or burning micturition. You can also use one natural product in UTI known as cranberry juice. Remember, cranberry juice, it has anti-E. coli property. Okay, it causes dislodgement or separation of E. coli from urinary tract. Cranberry juice is also found to be useful in UTIs. Okay, it is also found useful in UTIs. So these are the options we have for the treatment of UTI. Thank you very much.